was 'n Australiese man, en kind of regarded as the sort of the father of modern permaculture, or permaculture kind of as we know it today.
Mm-hmm.
And what it describes is a state of almost permanent culture, whereby you've got plants and animal species that kind of are able to live holistically together with one another, and essentially feeding into each other so that they almost perpetuate themselves. So it almost becomes the system whereby nature is allowed to unfold itself with a little bit of guidance from mankind, and ultimately just become this abundant, sort of, it's a vision of abundance, I suppose. Bill Mollison had visions of, you know, towns being full of useful foods and fruiting trees and things like that. Mm. And I think it's quite a compelling vision.
When I think of a permaculture, I think it's something huge. It's something that it just blows my mind. I don't have green fingers to start off. But when I think about permaculture, I think I see tractors and I see lots of people working land. Is that it?
Well, I'd say that's perhaps more agriculture, as we kind of have come to understand it over the last, call it, you know, maybe close to half a century or even a century, perhaps. And I think permaculture kind of takes a lot of those big monocropping agricultural fields and tractors and pivot points and all those kinds of things, and really does away with all of that, almost want to call it technological complexity. Mm. And it really breaks it down into very simple things. So the thing that fascinates me and gets me so excited about it is how, with a couple of simple tools and one man's energy, for example, you know, you can get so much done, because you can also work with a much softer touch then, you know, there's not such a heavy footprint on the environment, and you're able to be a lot more conscious in your application of these principles. Mm. So, yeah, I think there is definitely some distinction there.
And Ron, how long have you been doing or practicing permaculture?
Well, I suppose I've been really practically starting to apply these things that I've learned possibly over the last, I almost want to call it, 5 or 6 years. I've only really over the last 2 years gotten my hands dirty, no pun intended. But before that, I was a little bit more involved. I was working for an NGO in Cape Town called Green Pop. And Green Pop's all about, planting trees and growing gardens and saying no to single-use plastic and, you know, more plant-based diets. And a lot of these things that we really need to start to embrace and essentially become active citizens, and really start to take responsibility for the planet and for how we are interacting with it. And I suppose that really started me off and kind of got those levers ticking for me. And I think when I saw this big piece of, you know, bare plot in my folks' backyard in Oudtshoorn, I just thought, why can't we, why can't we have a garden going here, you know, and start, start growing food right here. It's like a very old school solar panel, you know, you can convert sunlight and a little bit of water and soil into something that actually has value. It's really magical.
This sounds very interesting, but I've read your CV. You actually have a background in, you worked for a creative CFO, which sounds a lot like numbers and tech stuff and complicated mathematical calculations. And now you're talking about farming.
So I
need to know the bridge between being, is it an auditor or somebody working with numbers, to a small farmer?
Well, yes, I suppose you could use the term accountant. I like to think of it more as business consultancy, or at least that's the way that I like to think about it. I leave the complicated tax things to the guys who know what they're talking about there. But yeah, so Creative CFO is very much, yeah, their vision is sort of a world where more SMEs or small to medium enterprises succeed. It's great to be involved in that. But yeah, I can see there is quite a big gap between the world of finance and let's call it the very real world of soil, sun, and water. Yeah. So I've always loved nature though. So I think it's just something that always calls me back. I do sometimes struggle sitting behind a computer for 8 hours a day. In fact, yeah.
But is there a way that you see that you can incorporate these two worlds into one world?
Oh, yes, absolutely. And I think I've always sort of had this feeling and maybe this, a premonition or whatever. But, you know, I've always thought the permaculturalists, and this is not to, you know, try to throw broad strokes at all of this, but the permaculture people are often very creative and earthy and spiritual and almost want to call it more almost right brain focused, lots of ideas and, you know, applications and all these kinds of things. And then the accountants are very sort of methodical and left brain, and things must fit neatly into this box and all of that kind of thing. And I think perhaps what the permaculturalists have maybe needed is kind of actually a bit of a marriage of those two worlds coming together. I think having clear and straightforward and simple systems, I see this in businesses all the time, you know, it's just, you know, clear, straightforward systems that people can follow, and, you know, then people that work within those systems also are able to derive a lot more fulfillment and joy from it, you know, knowing that they're doing their work properly and things are moving along as planned. But I think being able to marry that very creative, earthy side with a very sort of systematized and almost militant on the other, I think if you can blend those two nicely together, then then perhaps you can actually have a system that can scale.
And tell me, who can do permaculture? Can I start something? I have green fingers, remember?
So yeah, I think, you know, saying that whole thing of the green fingers. I remember once when I was in Cape Town, and now you're going to think I'm a real, earthy hippie for, but I was, you know, very much into yoga at that time. And I remember this one girl, when I told her I was doing yoga, she said, "Well, mom, it means you buy us loss via some yoga to do." And then I said, "No, that's why you do yoga, is so that you can become flexible, you know." I think being, you know, interacting with the soil is a very natural part of us, and I think everyone taps into it more easily than they think.
Yeah. When we come back from our music break, I definitely want to know how a person can get started with your own farm or garden or veggies or grow your own food. And we listen to one of Ron's music list, and we're listening to the Leeway from John Niklik. Did I say it right?
That's correct.
Okay. Enjoy the music, and we'll see you afterwards.
Anywhere can you see the clouds rolling in the wind?
Okay. Hey, Jason. Jason, daar is sommer dan vir my tyd, dan asseblief.
Ek maak vir jou, ja.
Baie dankie, dat raak so bietjie as ek hier gesê het, moet tyd hou. Dankie. Ronald, is daar iets spesifieks waaroor jy wil praat in die volgende segment?
Nee, Tia, ek dink ons is op 'n goeie trant. Ek dink as jy net ons hou die gesprek net aan die gang. Ek dink om te vra, wat kan 'n mens eintlik in jou eie kapasiteit doen om so iets te begin? Ek dink daar's 'n hele paar goeters wat ons daarin kan in Delft. So, ja.
Ja. Misschien kan ons praat oor precies hoe werk die... Wat doen my mense in Afrikaans?
Permacultuur.
Permacultuur. Misschien hoe werk dit? Hoe werk die systeem? Is het dis een ecosysteem? Is het een mini-ecosysteem? Of...
Ja,
is het een ecosysteem?
Absoluut, definitief. En ek dink dis waar die diversiteit van die, van die, van die goeders wat jy besluit om te plant, en jy weet, sekere plante bring sekere goggaatjies en dingetjies in, wat weer dan die peste
op
die
ander goeders. Nee?
Jy weet, as jy nou een groot land kool het, byvoorbeeld, jy weet, as die motte dit sien, of wat ook al, die cabbage moth dit sien, jy weet, dan sulle sommer allemaal daar, of die springkane, of wat ook al, en as die goeders tussen mekaar geplant is, dan skuil hulle mekaar amper en bied weerstand aan die peste en so aan.
Okay. Ek denk dit is wat jy definitief moet ek wil dit weet. Ek weet, wat is die dame by Spence Plaas waarmee ons gesel, wat Hans gesê het, ek het haar naam vergeet?
Catherine.
Catherine, ja.
Ja.
Ek was so beïndruk met haar, want toe ons by Spence Plaas was, toe sy vir, ek sal het nou op die program ook sê, toet Catherine, hier is Hans nou, toet Catherine verduidelik dat daar was pest op die een plant, en sy het niks gebruik om hulle te verwilder nie, en na week het daar ander type goeders wat daar die peste aangeval het en al verwilder het, maar die ander pest was nodig, of die ander dierkies was nodig vir fertilisatie, van weet die wat alles het.
Absoluut.
So dit is amper asof alles het so een proces. Hans, ons kan nie jou sien nie. Dat is ietsje voor jou camera. Ek hoop Hans kan ons hoor. Hans?
Hans? Hans, waar is jy?
Ek sien jy, ek gaan gof om my boodskap stuur.
Daar is
hy!
Daar is hy! Hy is terug!
Hoe ver het julle gekom?
Ons is klaar met die program, ons gaan nou huis toe.
Dis wat ons met Cyril gespot het.
Ja.
Linne Sambok.
Hans, ons gaan nog vraag. Jy kan verder gaan, Hans. En jy leid ons eindelijk die program vanaan. Maar ek het gedink ons praat nou oor hoe werk permaculture en wat het jy nodig om te begin mee.
Ja.
Dis waar ons nou is.
So Ronald, you've introduced yourself and spoke about how you got involved in it or not?
Not yet.
Okay, great. So
yes,
no,
kind
we
of.
Spoke about it. Kind of, yeah.
We did touch on that. Yes.
And I asked him, how does a left brain and a right brain function work together?
Okay, you spoke about an accounting person in this field. And I say that for me was also...
Slightly.
It was also nogal interessant. That a good combination.
Jason, by Ola, begin ons nog weer so real like van ons tyd steel.
Hoe bedoel jy nou, laat begin ons?
Wanneer gaan ons op die aan? Praat ons nog steeds?
O, daar is 6 secondes.
Wanneer is die advertentie klaar?
Die muziek is lang. Die song was een beetje lang. Daar is veel advertentie. Julle gaan nou gesels, hoor.
Chip on that beautiful car of yours. Glorious mistakes are anxiously waiting to be made. Your approval. And give expert advice and quality service on our custom work, auto body and collision repairs, chassis straightening, spray painting, and lots more. For more information, visit our website, www.villiespanelbeaters.co.za. For a free quotation and advice, visit us at 26 Foundry Street.
George Industria, or give us a call on 044-873-4967. Villy's Panel Beaters, precision workmanship with friendly customer service is our policy. Villy's Panel Beaters, the official sponsor of Church Actuality. Sundays between 2 and 3 p.m. on Eden FM, your voice in paradise.
You are tuned into your number one community radio station in the Western Cape and number three in South Africa. Live from the heart of the Garden Route, Eden FM, your voice in paradise.
Wel, welkom terug, luisteraars, hier bij ons het koppen bij elkaar. En sommer welkom aan Hans ook. Hans, lijkt me Eskom het jou beet gehad daarso.
Zeker wat Eskom of Afrihost of MTN was die, maar verskoning vir die luisteraars, jammer dat ek julle verlaat het.
Een van die het baie vraag. Companies, nee. Kan ek gou een vraag vra voor dat jy vra? Ja. Ek wil by Ronald weet, het een mens Eskom nodig vir Prima Culture? Want hulle bly ons in die steek laat.
Ek dink dis een van die wonderlike dinge van Prima Culture is dat jy baie minder afhankelijk is van die groot papa systeem. So ek dink dat is definitief een element van liberation betrokken.
Ja. So what attracted you to Prima Culture, Ron? And I mean, it's quite weird for me, like this person with accounting background, so very precise, and permaculture is more letting life take its course, but I'd like to hear it from you.
Yeah, I'm not really quite sure, Hans. I mean, I suppose, you know, my folks always raised us with an appreciation for nature. So I think that's always been there. And I suppose just this, I suppose in a sense, it's kind of when you think about this as a potential solution for a lot of the qualms that one sees in modern society, and how this is almost a return to sanity in a way. There's definitely a grounding that happens when you really become back in touch with nature and its cycles. I mean, even now I'm a lot more even aware of, you know, the cycle of the moon, for example, because of the garden and all these kinds of things. So I think it definitely, I suppose maybe more on the, yeah, it is actually a spiritual experience, I think, working in a garden and working with the soil and working with nature. So yeah, in a sense, I suppose, maybe it really does just fulfill a lot of sort of deep needs that I feel I have as a human being. So I suppose it draws everyone in on its own terms and in its own way. And I suppose, yeah, well, I think once you get bitten, then yeah, you kind of you're in it and you can't really unsee it, and you realize that this has profound implications for the way in which we're going to move into the future as a society and as a civilization. So I think permaculture is definitely springing up all over the world, and it's only, the concept is really only 50 years old. So I think we're going to be seeing a lot more of that, and not necessarily out of choice, but out of necessity.
Yeah. You say it's about 50 years old. And second question is, what is about the moon, being bothered by the moon, Ron?
No, it's just, well, I suppose many of the, you know, modern agricultural wouldn't pay too much mind to the moon, but it was strange when, you know, I started with this garden and how many times the moon actually came up, be it from, you know, having a chat with Catherine or even just, you know, chatting to someone who comes around and has a look. You know, the moon is the kind of constantly circled in those conversations. And then you kind of think, well, you know, it definitely is a natural cycle. So, you know, there are actually certain times to plant. And the old people really believed it. My grandfathers, actually on both my folks' side, on my dad and my mom, both of them were actually, I found out recently again, were big vegetable farmers. I mean, I always knew my grandfather in Barrydale, but I never met my mother's father, but he also up in De Ben in the Northern Cape had a, you know, almost in the Kalahari, also farming or growing vegetables in the backyard. So they planted by the moon, and they believe, you know, in that whole process. So yeah, I mean, there are lots of moving parts and things to keep in mind, but I suppose you'll find your rhythm with time and experience, and just, you know, the 10,000 hours, I suppose.
Yeah. What's this about the moon? So like on full moon, you do what, and when the moon is waxing? And
well, I'm actually going to throw Catherine under the bus, because this is how she explained it to me. She said, on the, okay, let me just get this 100% right. So sure. on the new moon, you plant your leafy greens, you know, so chard and lettuce and rocket and those kinds of things. And then on the first quarter, you'll plant your fruiting and flowering crops. And then at full moon, you'll plant your root crops, because now the moon's at its highest point, and, you know, and supposedly, you know, the energy pulls back down into the earth. So you plant your root crops. And then in the last quarter, they say you don't plant or prune or do anything. You actually just spend that time to, you know, tidy things up, get things sorted out, ready for kind of that next cycle. So yeah, I still have to do a lot of reading about that, but you know, that's kind of the basic premise of planting with the moon, I suppose.
Ron, I want to know, I asked you before we went on the break, can I start my own garden? And I said, I've got green thumbs. Why do I need to start the garden?
Well, I suppose a little bit of elbow grease, you know, always comes in handy. But yeah, I think if you've got a 1x1 meter block, and, you know, you build yourself a little bit of compost from the leaves in your garden and the grass clippings, and maybe a bit of horse manure that you can go get somewhere around town, I'm sure, you know, you build up a little bit of soil and you work your soil, and then try, I suppose, also not to dig it up all the time. You know, I think a lot of these permaculturalists actually advocate for this concept of no-till farming or no-dig gardening. You know, so the idea is really every time that you turn the soil, you're really breaking up a lot of those very fine layers, because certain parts of the ecosystem and that soil life also only exists at the top layer, and then another bunch of little organisms will be working at a slightly deeper layer, and, you know, so on. So the idea is to actually just kind of almost leave the soil as much as you can, and really just feed it from the top with your compost, and kind of just keep planting, you know, and sowing the seeds and looking after them and seeing what the plants do. I mean, that's really one of the big magical elements of growing a garden, is there's constantly something surprising you, you know, whether it's the fruit trees going into blossom, or a head of cauliflower that by the time you actually spot it, it's so big, and you think, how did I miss this whole time? It's been here, you know. So there's like these little surprises all the way through, you know, when you pick your first cherry tomato or your first peas off your plants, or, you know, you pick a big sunflower and, you know, you put it in a pot in the house, or whatever the case may be. It's it really kind of just, it draws you in that way.
It certainly does, yeah. But Theo, when I listen to Ron, what's so beautiful to me is this the permaculture being, it feels to me it's like in tune with the principles of nature and the principles of life. It's not, you know, like if for me, Ron, when I think of industrial farming, I do a lot of cycling, and then I cycle past these big fields, you know, and with this tilling, the soil gets turned around, and there's actually no life in it. You can see it's no life. And the reason why the crops grow is because of all the fertilizers. But what you're taking a completely opposite direction by saying cultivating the soil. And I think it also, in terms of human relationships, our society, it's also relevant there. How do we cultivate relationships? How do we cultivate the soil in terms of community?
Absolutely. I think, and this is the thing that Bill Mollison also explains in his writings, is that it really is such a broad toolkit, and if you can sort of think of, you know, there's this sort of these 12 principles of permaculture, and they've got three sort of guiding core ethics at the center of this, which is care for the earth, care for people, and fair share. So those are almost the sort of the three central ethical themes, you could almost say, of permaculture. And then there are the actual principles. You know? So principle one, for example, would be to observe and interact, and, you know, to catch and store energy, or, you know, obtain a yield, and to move slowly, you know, applying self-regulation and accepting feedback, all these kinds of things. It's almost as if it's this toolkit that you can use, and this lens through which you can view any given setup or scenario, and then really find a solution for that very unique, because if you can imagine, you know, all the diverse cultures and climates and people all over the world, it's just such diversity, and there just cannot possibly be a one size fits all solution that's just going to, you know, work without fail in any given situation. So what permaculture, these principles and these ways of looking and conceptualizing of the problem and finding solutions for them that are very, you could almost say, endemic to that specific space or that specific setup or culture, whatever the case may be. So it really becomes a toolkit for us to look at the problems that we're faced with, and then finding ways within which to just use the incredible forces of nature that are constantly at work all around us to actually, you know, produce something of value to us.
Yeah. What stuck with me, Thea, was now when Ron said to receive feedback, you know, and the disconnect that we see in our society, where feedback and blind spots are so all over, you know, in our lives.
I liked what you guys were talking about, and it reminded me actually of a scripture in Matthew 11 from verse 28 to 30, and I like the amplified version of it, because it talks about, it says, are you tired, worn out, burnt out on religion? Come to me, get away with me, and you'll recover your life. I'll show you how to take a real rest, walk with me and work with me. Watch how I do it, learn the unforced rhythms of grace. I won't lay anything heavy or ill-fitting on you, keeping company with me, and you learn to live freely and lightly. And when you were talking about what you were saying now, Ron, about just how the earth is there, the ground is there, water is there, and if we can just learn it, the earth, produce and allow it to produce in its own time, and allow ourselves to watch the signs and read the times and go with that rhythm instead of having our own rhythm. And I think the one you're talking about is about creating food and generating your own food and taking responsibility for generating your own food.
I mean, that's beautifully said. Yeah, it's like right at the heart of permaculture. Yeah, that's absolutely 100%.
Yeah. Sure. Hier in FM luisteraars, ek word baie diep geraak met die groen vingers van my. Dit voel vir my, ek kan nou in die grond gaan werk. Kom ons luister gou so 'n bietjie na musiek en ons terugkom en praat ons weer verder. As julle vrae het, kan julle natuurlik in WhatsApp, julle weet, en dan kan julle vrae vir Ron of net vrae het Ron permaculture as julle het. Ek is seker julle het Eden FM so WhatsApp nommer. Ek sal dit weer net na advertensiebreek vir julle deurgee. Ons luister nou na Know Your Bones deur, is dit A King?
A King.
A King. Wonderlik. Sien julle na die musiekbreek.
Glorious mistakes are anxiously waiting to be made. In the nervous arms of breakdown, I find embrace. You shake when you've got nothing to say. I know you're.
Okay, thank you. Sure, Ron. Ek weet, ek is eintlik so 'n bietjie stand. Ek dink ons het vergeet hoe om so te lewe. Laat ek vra wat by my opgekom.
Daar is 'n baie sentrale punt wat ek het eintlik baie daaroor daai presiese ding gedink die afgelope ruk. Is dis kind of net hierdie, is amper van 'n effense, ja, wat is die woord wat ek nou soek, but we have forgotten to some extent, or we've just temporarily been misled. maybe that's not quite the way to put it, but ons is, ja, amper al van die slaap, van hierdie deel van ons, wat eintlik soveel waarde aan die mense lewe bring en soveel vreugde. En ja, ek dink met ons moderne samelewing is daar net hierdie absolute afstand tussen ons en ons kos. En ek dink wanneer 'n mens weer met dit herkonnekteer, dan is dit eintlik 'n baie spesiale ding. So
ek dink weer eens dat you know, sê is belangrik, maar ek sou graag wil weet. Ek hou van praktiese goeders, en dis nou seker my fisiek kant, nie? Ek wil weet, hoeveel, jy het nou net gesê, 1 by 1 meter, is al wat jy nodig het. Ek wil regtig weet, hoe begin jy? Hoeveel geld het jy nodig? Want ek denk nie, Jason, ek weet nie, of jy sal met my sal stem, daar is soveel mense wat by julle huise sit, wat as hulle net kan, hulle eie tuine het. As jy elke dag uit jou tuine kan eet, ek ben joh. Wat jy sê?
Stem 100% saam. Ek bedoel, kyk hoe die waarde van goed opgegaan die afgelope paar maande. So, en ek bedoel, een stukje grond kan soveel meer beteken vir jou as a gesin. Iwan is 'n enkeling ook, as jy daar is, dat jy iets met dit kan doen, as we dit daar ongebruik staan. En ek dink, Ron, soos jy sê, as hy kan sê, maar dit is die stappe wat jy moet doen, dit is wat jy benodig, dit is wat die kostes is rondom dit. So mense dat ook sien, maar dis gaat nie so 'n dier proces in die einde van die dag nie. Maar baie keer dink jy, dis a baie dier proces om dier te gaan.
Ek dink ek het 'n goeie angle vir ons nou, as jy net weer dalk die vraag kan stel, dan dink ek sal ek hierdie keer nou eintlik 'n beter antwoord vir jou het, ja.
Hans, Hans, ek sê nou net, ek dink dalk in die laaste segment moet ons praat oor mense wat by die huis is, wat 'n stukkie grond het, wat sukkel, finansieel sukkel. Hoe begin jy, wat maak jy, hoe kan jy hierdie proses aan die gang sit? Hoeveel geld het jy nodig om te begin? En. Praktiese goeders. Nee? Dink ek moet ons vra.
Dank jy julle reg. Is Hans daar?
Okay. Nee.
Ek dink Hans het weer gefries.
Hans? Okay, ons is so 40 sekondes oor van die advertensie.
Sy man sikkel van die hand om...
Ek is hier so, maar ek gooi my, ek beloof vir ek is 10 sekondes op, dan as ek sien, dan restart hy weer, kom ons hoop dat ek kan inbly.
Ok.
Ons maak die beste.
Permaculture.
279 en die vriendelike en professionele manne sal jou gauw uitsorteer. Kom ek van jou somme, gauw tot daar.
Ek sê jou.
JFK Motors, kom besoek ons vandag nog, want vir 'n voertuig hoef jy nie te sukkel nie.
Join Cash Converters George for their first birthday celebration on 16 October between 10:30 and 12:30 in the morning. Entertainment includes an outside broadcast with Eden FM Radio. As part of the celebration, they are giving away 4x500 Cash Converters vouchers to 4 lucky customers. Be there on 16 October or you might miss out. Cash Converters is situated at 96 York Street in George.
Wel, welkom terug, Eden FM luisteraars. Ons praat met Ronald Stevens, hier van Oudswering, en Ronald praat met ons oor permaculture vanavond. Ek het voor die advertentiebreek het gesê, as julle wil vraag, is julle welkom om dit te vraag. Die nommer is 060-505-2693 en julle kan julle WhatsApp instuur om nou te vraag. En ek het nou al klaar gebieg en gesê, ek weet niks van plant of enige ietsie. Al my goedjies, selfs my kaktusplantjies gaan dood, Ronald. Maar ek is definitief geïnteresseerd om te weet, hoe begin jy dit? Ek dink nie, daar is baie mense wat nou by hulle huise sit en luister. Permaculture, dit is so'n groot woord en so'n hoë woord. Dit is seker net vir mense wat baie geld het. En klomp lande het. Maar die mense, ek kan nie dit self doen nie. Maar, hoe begin jy?
Right, ek dink hierdie keer sal ek jou vraag mooier beantwoord, Tiama. Kom ons stel het so. The soil is our primary asset. That's where it begins. So, as jy enige iets kan doen om jou grond te bou, dan is dit waar mens moet begin. So, kom ons sê, die een ding wat jy moet hê is 'n komposhoop. Jy kan al jou grassnysels en jou blare, daar, ek vat sommer net 3 of 4 palette, en ek sit hulle in 'n kubieke meter boks, sommer met draad vastgebind, en die een is nou 'n deur, en dan begin jy nou net volgooi van bo af. As jy voel jou tuin gee nie vir jou genoeg blare en gras nie, dan gaan vra jou buurmanne, hulle bied later aan vir jou om die goeders te bring, en jy sal verbaas wees met hoe bly en bereid mense is om hulle sakke blare vir jou te gee. Dit is regtig vir my altyd so ongelooflik. Dan die tweede ding wat jy kan doen is jy kan 'n paar aardwurms, die red wrigglers, is nou spesifiek die composting earthworm, jy kan 'n paar by my kom kry tee, en dan jy weet, dan sit jy hulle nou in 'n bakkie en jy gooi al jou kombuis scraps vir jou aardappelskille en jou al die tipe. Daar's 'n paar goedjies waarvan hulle nie hou nie, citrus is hulle nou nie so jy weet, groot fans van nie, maar dan kan jy ten minste. Kompos, goeders wat jy kan gebruik om jou grond mee aan te vul. Dan sou ek sê, kyk 'n bietjie na jou watersituasie. As jy 'n bietjie van jou grys water kan vang en water wat op die dak val, jy weet, hulle sê op 'n vierkante meter, as dit 1 mm reën op 'n vierkante meter, is dit 'n liter. So jy kan vir jouself gaan uitwerk wat hoeveel. As jy nou 'n reënmeter het in jou tuin, kan jy nou gaan uitwerk presies hoeveel water sal nou val op jou dak as het nou gesê het 5 mm, dan weet jy, okay, ek moes nou so baie liter in my tanks gekry het of wat ook al die geval mag wees. Dan, ja, dan is het maar ook maar 'n geval van wanneer jou grond nou lekker aan die gang is, begin jy nou net jou saaikies en goedjies lekker dalk in truis begin en dan, ja, van daar af begin die opwinding eintlik nou in die magic, so te sê, waar mense nou eintlik kyk hoe die plantjies groei in hierdie grond wat jy net die hele tyd besig is om aan te vul en te bou, en sodra jou 1x1 meter blok nou vol kompos is en het staan amper so effens so hoopie daar soos wat die plant nou uit dit uitgroei en goed, dan sê jy, okay, maar nou het ek 'n lekker gevoel vir die ding, kom ons doen nog so 2 vierkante meter of wat ook al die geval mag wees, en dan binnenkort dan groei jy sommer 'n paar goeders vir jou buurmanne en so, en so kom ons aan die gang en begin ons klein en werk ons self op.
So jy sê, jy begin net eers met die blare wat in die tuin inval, of jou gras wat jy gesny het, of enige afvalstompe of takke of sulke tipe goeders in een container. Ek het al gesien, mense het hierdie groot wiele wat hulle gebruik om soms kompos in te maak. Jy weet die binneband of buiteband wat hulle gebruik. En dan die tweede ding is die erfrems, oor ek gril som as ek dink aan dit, ek hoop iemand anders kan dit vir my doen. En dan sit jy nou jou afval, aardappelskille, piesangskille, watse skille ook as ek jy daarin, en die erfrems kom saam met die gras, die hele gemengsel kom saam. En die ander ding wat nogal belangrik is, wat jy nou gesê het, is om jou grijswater op te vang, dis nou jou wasmachine water, of sulke type water, wat jy gebruik, en ook jou reenwater.
Ja, ek dink, ja, mens moet oppas vir baie van jou grijswaterbronne, so, jy weet, baie van die chemikalie wat hulle in die sepe en so het, is eintlik nou nie baie goed vir 'n mens se grond en die mikroorganismes wat nou daar binne wil lewe nie. So mens moet oppas vir dit. Ek sou eintlik dalk 'n bietjie teen dit gaan. En sê reënwater is absoluut wonderlik. Ons het nou nie te veel van dit hier in Oudtshoorn en altyd nie.
Maar
daar is altyd 'n klein bietjie water wat 'n mens iewers kan afknyp. Jy weet, selfs al jy weet, het jy een systeem waar jy die water in van jou stort, dan sê jy, jy weet, hierdie keer gaan ek nou, jy kry dalk die speciale seepie of so, wat jy self mee kan was, en dan, jy weet, twee keer in die dag, dan gebruik jy nou dat, jy weet, een keer elke maand jy nou jou haare was, en al die type van dinge doen, jy weet. dat die mens eindelijk dan skoner goeders begin gebruik, wat die mens dan eindelijk daai water kan gebruik in 'n mens se tuin.
En dit is eenvoudig, dis alles afvalprodukte waarmee jy begin, en dan uit dit uit, kan jy dan jou eie kos produseer. So vir enige gesin wat daar buiten is, ek dink as jy net jou eie aardappels uit jou tuin uit kan kry, of jou eie eie uit jou tuin uit kan kry, dit is 'n sakkie aardappels wat jy nie hoef te koop nie. Of dis een sakkie eie wat jy nou hoef te koop, meer aan.
Ja, sorry Thea, ek het jou nou vir 'n oomblik al verloor, elke keer wanneer jy bos wortels uit jou tuin uittrek, dan dink jy, yes, like it, kyk hier, ja, dit is varser as enige ding wat jy gaan kry in 'n winkel, en dis verniet, jy weet, gesondheid uit die grond uit. So, ek dink, dis definitief iets wat ook een ekonomiese incentief aan het gekoppel het, ook in tot een mate, hoe ons eindelijk net met een bykie grond, een bykie sonlig, een bykie water en een hele klompie geduld narik, kan jy nie eindelijk bybly met die oes nie, jy weet, en dan besef jy, maar hier gaan nou een hele ander ding aan, en dan het jy meer as genoeg om, jy weet, een van die core principles van permaculture, which is fair share, jy weet, dan het jy eindelijk meer as genoeg, nie net vir jouself, maar ook vir die mense wat om jou is.
Dus ek het, wat ek by jou hoor, jy maak die kompost van jou bier is een afvalgrond wat so diep toe gegaan het, en wat jy nou sê, versier die deel ook met die mense om jou van dit wat jy geoes het. Maar as ek nou jou vir jou kan vraag, typies as jy nou eet in die aand, wat se gedeelte van die kos op jou tafel, in jou bord, kom uit jou tuin uit?
Wel, Hans, die snaakse ding van die tuin is, dit laat jou eindelijk, dit verander effens jou eetgewoontes, jy weet. My meisie Ellie, wat baie keer nou die inkopies en so gaan doen, sy sê, dit is pas so lekker om nie nou in die groente gang af te loop, nie, want jy weet, sy kom huis toe en daal het sy klein stukje hoender, maar dan, jy weet, dan is daar wortels en boontjies en erkies en een raap of twee en spinasieblare en een broccoli en een blomkool, jy weet, en dan maak sy sommer een lekker, jy weet, Thai green chicken curry ding, jy weet, en dan die enigste ding in die hele dis wat gekoop was die hoender. Ek is nou een bietjie te sag om die hoender self te slag. Ek dink dis nou deel sal regkom met die permaculture ding nie, jy weet, is een hoenderse kop nou, jy weet, af. So ek
Ron, hoor is om, ek wil net weet, waar kan die mense, want ek word nou hier indirect gechallenged, die Jason, wat sê, hy denk volgende jaar hierdie tyd moet hy, Jason, is dit dan nou jou verloofde of jou vrou nou al, na my toe kom vir 'n maaltyd en hy wil uit my tuin uit eet.
Ja, dis nou letterlik die span wat die sit, so Ron, jy is genooi, Hans, jy is genooi, ons nooi onsself dan na Tia toe.
Lyk vir my, het stekende idee.
Dat so Ron die worms moet bring.
Wel Tia, ek sê vir jou wat, ons gaan jou nie in die diepkant ingooi nie, ek speel nou al vir 'n lang tyd met hierdie konsep, dat ek eintlik, jy weet, vir mense gaan help om hulle eie kleine tuintjie aan die gang te kry, net met die minimale, absolute, bare minimum input, en net ietsie aan die gang te begin kry, so, dal kan ons het guinea pig daar by jou tuin, en jy weet, dal kan ek my konsep ook 'n bietjie meer, hoe kan een mens sê, give it some body, ek is meer as gelukkig om
half vir jou. Dis 'n deal.
Great.
Ja, luisteraars, ons praat vanavond hier met Ronald Stevens. Ek weet nie of ek mag sê hoe ek hom nou leer ken het vanavond nie, maar ons praat oor permaculture, ons praat oor hoe om jou eie kos te vervaardig. Klink dit nie amazing, Hans?
Ja, weet jy, ek hou van Ron, when you were talking about, dus om klein te begin, jy weet, ek het vir onszelf, ons het begin met spinasie, en jy weet nou het ons sien nou maar 1.5 by 2.5 meter tankie, en dis amazing, ons het nou vanaand, wat jy van praat van, jy weet jou eie greens in die kos te, en mens begin ook anders te eet, omdat dit wat jy eet, dit wat beskikbaar is. Lekker om te luister.
Ja, nou is ons het tyd af jy verby, Ron. Enige laaste woorde wat jy vir die luisteraars hier buite wil sê?
Ek dink, net as 'n afsluiting, ek dink baie mense sal verbaas wees oor hoe vinnig hulle regtig hierdie proses van die grondwerk en kos te groei. Dis so diep, ek kan sê, almost an innate human a need to kind of be in touch with that side of ourselves. I think you'd be surprised at how quickly you get into it. And yeah, YouTube and the internet, it's an incredible resource. You know, anything you want to know, anything at all, any time of day. You know, we've all got phones with the internet connection. You can just check it out right there and then. So yeah, I think if the will is there to learn, then yeah, it'll be an incredible adventure and a lovely, a beautiful journey of discovery, really.
Amazing. Baie dankie, Ron. Hans, enige laaste woord van jou af?
Ja, ek dink hierdie is deel van Klinker Connect se poging om groter bewustheid te skep rondom voedselsekerheid. Nie net voedselhulp waar ons vir mense kos gee wat nie kos het nie, maar dat ons self onderhoudend kan word. En ja, dankie Ron. Thanks for sharing your ideas and asseblief gaan kyk na Klinker Connect se Facebook page om so 'n bietjie Ron se tyd te sien.
Ja.
Thanks Hans, it's been great.
Ja. Ja, Eden FM luisteraars en Jason, ek gaan julle uitdaging aanvat en ek aanvaar jou aanbod Ron om mee te kom help met my tuin. En dan wil ek bysê, soos ek groen vingers het, dan wie ook na buite vanaand luister, ek daag julle ook sommer uit om met julle eie tuin te begin help by julle huise. Begin klein en laat ons groot gaan, hè. So julle kan altyd weer na hierdie klip luister. Dit word op YouTube opgelaai binne 'n week se tyd. Google YouTube, ons kop in mekaar en Ronald Stevens en ek kan julle weer luister. So sien julle volgende week wanneer ons weer kop by mekaar sit. Ons luister na Stay the Same deur Slightly Stupid. Lekker week vir julle.
I'm so tired and my back is so sore.
It's time for a new bed, my love.
Why wait? Get up from your old bed and visit our showroom at 14 Discovery Road, George.